am Dr. Crystal Downing. I am the co-director of the Marion E. Wade Center, along with my husband, the other co-director. And we are delighted to have you here at the second installment of the fourth annual Ken and Jean Hansen Lectureship, which is named after a former college trustee, Ken Hansen, and his wife, Jean. And we are delighted to have Ken and Jean's son, Dr. Walter Hansen, with us tonight, and his delightful wife, Darlene. So thank you both for being here. As many of you know, the first two collective lectureships have resulted in some books made possible by IVP Academic, which has done a fantastic job. And we just got some good news. The first collection is called Messiah Comes to Middle Earth by Dr. Philip Ryken. And it's already in its fourth printing. And the second collection, George MacDonald in the Age of Miracles by Timothy Larson, is already in its second printing, and it just came out this fall. So that is very exciting. And we want to invite you to stop and buy copies of these books. We have copies that are signed by the authors at the bookstore after our evening's events are over. So I would like to begin by asking Dr. Walter Hansen to open in prayer. He has been involved with the Wade since its very inception, and he is an important member of the Wade board. So, Dr. Hansen.
Thank you, Crystal. One of the delights of being involved in this is to be able to pick up favorite books off the shelf, whatever's being featured in the evening. And so I pick off a book by C.S. Lewis here, and I just showed Jerry that my father gave this to me in 1977. And so I read a very short poem, not a long poem like Dymer, very short poem, Prayer. Master, they say that when I seem to be in speech with you, since you make no replies, it's all a dream, one talker aping two. They're half right, but not as they imagine. Rather, I seek in myself the things I mean to say, and lo, the wells are dry. Then, seeing me empty, you forsake the listener's role, and through my dead lips breathe into utterance awake the thoughts I never knew. And thus, you neither need reply nor can, thus while we seem two talking, thou art one forever, and I no dreamer, but thy dream. Father God, we love you because you first loved us before we ever knew you and called us to be your children and sent your Son to the world to redeem us and your Spirit into our hearts that we might cry, Abba. And we pray that your Spirit in our hearts will give us listening hearts and ears to receive all that you have to teach us tonight through your servant Jerry and Mark. We thank you for them and for your servant C.S. Lewis. In the name of Jesus our Lord, amen.
Thank you. With no further ado, I will introduce both speakers. Dr. Jerry Root hardly needs an introduction because he's a force of nature on this campus and all around the world, where he gets invited to speak on C.S. Lewis repeatedly. And he is, as many of you know, a fantastic speaker. He has a PhD from the Open University and currently serves as the director of the Institute for Strategic Evangelism at the Billy Graham Center here at Wheaton, where he also teaches in the Christian Formation and Ministry Department and in the Evangelism and Leadership Master's Program. He and his wife, Claudia, have four grown children and 13 grandchildren, and I'm now going to say something that has probably never been used to introduce you before, but Jerry lives next door to his sister, and I love that. Responding to Jerry's lecture will be Mark Lewis, director of theater here at Wheaton, who has an MFA from Southern Methodist University. And before we got the benefits of his talents here at Wheaton, he was a professional actor in New York City for 15 years and was on stage with actors like Al Pacino, Martin Sheen, Julianne Moore, F. Murray Abraham, and I could go on. This is pretty impressive. So if you see this aura, that's where it comes from, including his talent. He has directed more than 40 plays since 1994, including an adaptation of C.S. Lewis's Till We Have Faces in 2014. Did anybody see that? I am very envious. I would have loved to have seen that. He is program director of the Wheaton Shakespeare Project, which has led to Wheaton's Shakespeare in the Park, and I was privileged to see the production of Tempest this summer, which was fantastic. After Mark gives his response to Jerry, we will have a 5-minute break in order to set up chairs for a panel discussion so that you'll have a chance to ask questions. And if you need to leave surreptitiously, that would be the time to do so. Now, please welcome Dr. Root, whose presentation has the wonderfully evocative title, C.S. Lewis's Dymer, Brooding Alone Beneath the Strength of Things.
Thank you, Dr. Downing. You know what, too? Christine Colon is here, Professor Colon. I saw her just a minute ago, and she did the third series of lectures. So your book comes out next year when the lectures come out, I think. And anyway, I'm grateful to be among you. It's funny, before I begin, some people say, why did you pick Dymer? And I've been scratching my head wondering that too a little bit. I don't like to explore things that have been well trafficked. So this is a book that not many people even read. Some people don't even know it exists. And yet, the more work I've done on it, sometimes I think, yeah, I can understand why people didn't do much on it. But anyway, let's go on from there, you brave souls. All right. In my first lecture, I sought to acquaint readers with the story of C.S. Lewis's narrative poem, Dymer. It was the only narrative poem published during his lifetime, and one of only two books published before his conversion to Christianity. Lewis had hopes of becoming a poet. Unfortunately, Dymer was not well received, and this convinced Lewis he would have to make his living some other way. Nevertheless, Dymer does reveal something of the rigor Lewis put into cultivating his skills as a writer. He learned the economy of words and the value of carefully selecting a literary form to match what he wanted to say. These served him well and contributed to his success as a prose writer. While Lewis never achieved commercial success as a poet, still Dymer remains important as a literary artifact for all who want to understand him fully. Furthermore, Dymer, before it is anything else, is a story and reveals something of Lewis's creative imagination. And by the way, it's a story I like very, very much, and I think that's one of the biggest reasons why I chose it. In my last lecture, I sought to set forth the story for those unacquainted with the narrative. Furthermore, I pointed out that the book has continuity with Lewis's later work. In fact, an early example of one of Lewis's biggest ideas, that reality is iconoclastic. In this chapter, I want to look at influences on Lewis as he wrote. This is not to suggest that Dymer is autobiography. Lewis says explicitly in a letter to his friend Arthur Greaves, I am not Dymer. Nevertheless, in his preface to the second edition of Dymer, he does write about various ideas that to one degree or another are in evidence in his poem. These influences and their effect on the manuscript are the subject of this lecture. Furthermore, Dymer has much in seed destined to blossom into full flower, and that will be the topic of my third lecture. In 1950, the publisher released a second printing of Dymer, for which Lewis wrote a preface. With characteristic humility, he says that since the publisher sought to disturb its repose in the grave, he felt he should be present at the exhumation. In this preface, he highlights those things that changed both in him and around him, as he concedes that these things within and without have influence on him as he wrote. There are also influences detected by internal evidence, and these are implicit in the poem itself. This includes Lewis's World War I experience. In addition, letters he wrote while working on Dymer reveal other influences. And furthermore, reflections preserved in his autobiography, Surprised by Joy, show that Lewis was also deeply affected by myth. In the preface, Lewis makes explicit mention of many things that he felt would be useful to a reader of the poem. These topics are those of escape, the Christiana dreams, the new psychology, and the lifelong experiences of longing that haunted him from childhood. I will look at each of these concepts with some detail. One more thing, Lewis said, this story arrived complete in my mind somewhere about my 17th year. This is evidence of Lewis's pictorial imagination. He often writes about stories that seem to appear almost full-bodied in his imagination. I am not sure even Lewis understood how this works, for he wrote, "It came." I doubt if we shall ever know more of the process called inspiration than those two monosyllables tell us. These moments of inspiration were coupled with the pleasure he took in exercising his imagination to hone his skill as a storyteller to produce this literary artifact. The implicit influence of World War I. There are several verses in the various cantos of Dymer where Lewis's war experiences seem to influence the narrative. He fought in the Battle of the Somme, at Monchy-le-Preux, at Fampoux, and Mont-Bernicon. I went and visited all those sites years ago because I wanted to see them. I like to see Lewis's world. There's one biography that says that Lewis was wounded taking a mountain, referring to Mont-Bernicon. Mont-Bernicon is as mountainous as Mount Prospect, Illinois. He saw firsthand the horrors of trench warfare. He was horribly injured, bearing scars for the rest of his life. Several verses from various cantos give evidence of his war experience. Dymer's adventures bring him to a man wounded, blind, and dying. He speaks to Dymer, "Listen, I've bled too deep to last out till morning. I'll be dead within the hour. Sleep then. I've heard it said they don't mind at last, but this is hell. If I'd the strength, I'd have such things to tell." Dymer learns this man was also bolting from the city. Now blind, his arms cut off and bleeding to death, the wounded man tells his story to Dymer. Here to his shock, he learns that in the wake of his flight from the city, a rebellion broke out led by an anarchist named Bran. Bran, ascending to unchecked power, then turns on his comrades, mortally wounding this man. Unaware with whom he is speaking, the dying man curses the memory of Dymer for acts that prompted the rebellion. As Lewis describes the man's condition, it is difficult not to believe something of death in the trenches and the horrors of battle were proximate to his mind as he wrote. Furthermore, it is likely something of his war experiences were vivid in his memory as the voice of the wounded man confesses. "Here I first heard the bullets sting the air. And again, like swarming bees, their spraying bullets came, no time for breath. I saw men's stomachs fall out on their knees and shouting faces while they shouted freeze into black bony masks. Before we knew, we were into them. Swine, die then, that's for you. And also, I saw an old man lying before my feet with shattered skull and both my arms drip blood." The images of hand-to-hand combat in no man's land, the unmistakable reference to gas masks as well as dismemberment, and the German shouts as the battle rages are clear inferences to trench warfare. In fact, apart from a few letters, these may be the most explicit revelations of Lewis's recollections of the war. The influence of his war memories seemed obvious. There was more. Having left this man, Dymer travels on and finally sleeps out in the open when suddenly from dreaming he woke wide into present horror, screaming. He was dreaming of the arms of his beloved when the dream suddenly turns into a nightmare and was filled with night alarms and rapping guns and men with splintered faces. No eyes, no nose, all red, were running races with worms along the floor. Here a reader can easily imagine that when the battles were long behind him, Lewis's memories still haunted his sleep, and these memories of war linger, influencing what he writes so vividly in Dymer. The implicit influence of myth. Another implicit influence on the writing of this Dymer poem is Lewis's strong and abiding interest in mythology. Lewis makes only slight reference to myth in the preface, yet he does say much about his love of myth in letters written while composing Dymer, and reveals more still about that time in his autobiography. The flavor of myth is pervasive in the poem because the lifelong love of myth was pervasive in Lewis from early childhood and throughout his life. In Surprised by Joy, Lewis told the story of his pilgrimage from atheism to Christianity. He recalls that in his earliest days, a longing was awakened in him, but the object of this longing was not clear. Various things called to his interior life, beauty, nature, the quality that met him in the books he was reading, and so forth. However, one of the things that fed this longing was an emerging interest in myth generally, and Norse mythology most of all. In his autobiography, he writes that these Norse myths became for him more important than anything else he did. These myths focused his longing on stories that contained elements of the transcendent and supernatural. This aroma is also pervasive in Dymer. Lewis chronicles the coupling of this longing with the myths and the part they played in nudging him towards whatever object might satisfy them. Consequently, Lewis was interested in anything related to myths. It was during this time in his life he picked up interest in Wagner's musical depictions of these stories. He never forgot the day when he walked into the Belfast shop of T. Edens Osborne. The shop still stands there to this day, though it's under other ownership. And he heard the Ride of the Valkyries playing. It was etched in his memory and fed his passion for the music depicting this world. He spent all of his pocket money to buy records of The Ring and Lohengrin and Parsifal. Lewis notes that the myths did something else for him as well. If northernness seemed then bigger than my religion, that may partly have been because my attitude toward it contained elements which my religion ought to have contained and did not. It was not itself a new religion, for it contained no trace of belief and imposed no duties. Yet unless I am greatly mistaken, there was in it something very like adoration and some kind of disinterested self-abandonment to an object which sincerely claimed this by simply being the object it was. He continues, sometimes I can almost think that I was sent back to the false gods there to acquire some capacity for worship against the day when the true God should recall me to himself. Not that I might not have learned this sooner and more safely in ways I shall now never know, without apostasy, but that divine punishments are also mercies, and particular good is worked out of particular evil, and penal blindness main sanative. At this time, Lewis understood myth to be a story that has a quality about it where the words or the medium of communication are less significant than the story itself. In fact, the story can be communicated many ways. The Greek word mythos simply means story, but these stories, as Lewis understood them, work upon us by their particular flavor or quality, rather as a smell or chord does. He adds that the story may be sad or joyful, but it is always grave. The reason for the gravity is that the story is felt to be numinous, transcendent, awe-inspiring, as if something of great moment has been communicated to us. In this sense, Lewis says that a myth is extra literary. I think Dymer is Lewis's attempt to try to depict this for his readers. Benjamin Jowett, the eminent English translator of Plato, wrote introductions to accompany each dialogue as he translated it. These introductions were published in a single volume. Here Jowett says that philosophy begins with the myths and the quest of the ancients to make sense of their experience. The myths were attempts to explain by means of story the significance of observed natural phenomenon. Sometimes conflicting accounts came to be, and these in turn eventually led to critical thinking as the ancients debated the relative merits of contrasting myths. All of this was an attempt to make sense of one's experience and one's place in the world. Therefore, myths were a quest for meaning. This was certainly so for Lewis. Myth gave him a vehicle by which he sought to make sense of his own longings, seeking to understand what they might mean and to direct his search to find their proper object. It is only natural to suppose that as Lewis wrote Dymer, his pleasure in myth-making, or mythopoeia as he called it, and his sense of longing would have an influence on the poem. Lewis is able to summarize the myth of Dymer simply enough. My hero was to be a man escaping from illusion. He begins by egregiously supposing the universe to be his friend and seems for a time to find confirmation of his belief. Then he tries, as we all try, to repeat his moment of youthful rapture. It cannot be done. The old matriarch sees to that. On top of his rebuff comes the discovery of the consequences which his rebellion against the city has produced. He sinks into despair and gives utterance of the pessimism which had, on the whole, been my own view about 6 years earlier. Hunger and shock of real danger bring him to his senses, and he at last accepts reality. But just as he is setting out on the new and soberer life, the shabbiest of all brides is offered him, the false promise that by magic or invented illusion, there may be a shortcut back to the happiness he remembers. He lapses and swallows the bait. But he has grown too mature to be really deceived. He finds that the wish fulfillment dream leads to the fear fulfillment dream, recovers himself, defies the magician who tempted him, and faces his destiny. At the time he was writing, Lewis was also rereading the Hippolytus by Euripides. In Surprised by Joy, he recounts the significance of this. It occurred at a time when he says God was closing in on him. Inspired by this reading of Euripides, Lewis says, I was once more into the land of longing. Furthermore, he underscores that the reading of this myth had a noteworthy influence on his coming to faith. This is all happening as he's writing Dymer. In this regard, Dymer takes on further significance. It is a window into the influences at play while Lewis was progressing towards faith. As Euripides tells the story, Hippolytus was the son of Thusis, an Amazon. Aphrodite hates Hippolytus because he has pledged his allegiance to Artemis, her rival among the goddesses, rather than to Aphrodite. Therefore, Aphrodite casts a spell on Thusis's current wife, Phaedra, causing her to desire Hippolytus, her stepson. Aphrodite's intention is to stir Thusis to jealousy so he will destroy his own son. Phaedra struggles between the spell to cast love to the spell cast to love Hippolytus and her desire to be faithful to her husband. Her nurse, detecting Phaedra's struggle, invites her to confide her secret. Phaedra confesses her love for Hippolytus. The nurse, seeking to broker a union between Phaedra and Hippolytus, lets the secret of Phaedra's love become a point of gossip and scandal. Unable to resolve the conflict within her and horrified at the false gossip about her, Phaedra takes her own life. When Thusis becomes aware of the gossip but not the actual truth, he rushes to judgment and banishes his son. Hippolytus. Thusis's judgment is both uninformed and cruel. Consequently, Hippolytus suffers unduly because of his father's cruelties. Artemis appears to tell Thusis that he has made judgments without full understanding. Thusis is beside himself with the loss of his wife, and now his son is dying. Nevertheless, before he dies, Hippolytus is carried to his father, and in his presence, as he dies, he forgives his father. Thusis is overwhelmed by his son's willingness to forgive in the very hour of his own death. The play ends with the chorus singing these words, on all our citizens hath come this universal sorrow unforeseen. Now shall the copious tear gush forth, for sad news about great men makes more than unusual hold upon the heart. In fact, no less than 5 of Euripides' plays end with the words very similar to the sentiments of the Hippolytus. Many are the shapes that fortune takes, and oft the gods bring things to pass beyond our expectation. That which we deem so sure is not unfulfilled, for while that we never thought would be, God finds out a way, and such hath been the issue in the present case. What significance does this have when it comes to Lewis's Dymer? The message throughout is that reality is iconoclastic. In addition, Hippolytus underscores another feature of the influence of myth on Lewis. His early letters show he had no real interest in Euripides. However, something changed in him. Later, by his own admission, Hippolytus influences his own writing, and in fact becomes the inspiration at the root of another of his narrative poems, The Queen of the Drum. On March 4th, 1924, Lewis writes in his journal, while he is writing Dymer, that Hippolytus is splendid stuff. And just before his conversion to Christianity, the first move in the process where God puts him in checkmate was the reading of the Hippolytus. There are several very important things to note in relation to Dymer. Just as the characters in Euripides' play must accept their fate, so too Lewis mentions in his preface, my hero at last accepts reality. The stoicism is also noticeable in Dymer's accepting his fate and resigning himself to reality. These tributaries coming from the springs of Euripides feed into the stream of Lewis's growing commitment to the idea that reality is iconoclastic. Furthermore, it is because Lewis held this vision of reality that he was able to move away from his early atheism back to God as the object of his deepest longing. Since evidence of this move can be seen in Dymer, the poem is once again an important literary artifact chronicling Lewis's progress toward an eventual conversion to Christianity. Lewis wrote to Greaves as he was revising Dymer that he said, Dymer is changed to ask. You remember ask and embola, Lewis writes in The North Mist. He was also thinking of changing the title to Redemption of Ask. Ask and embola in these myths were, in the Eddas, the equivalents to Adam and Eve. The association of Dymer with Nordic mythology is made explicit here. Lewis makes more connections between Dymer and the Norse myths in the same letter and recounts the late-night talk he had with Hugo Dyson and J.R.R. Tolkien shortly before his conversion. Now, what Dyson and Tolkien showed me was that if I met the idea of sacrifice in a pagan story, I didn't mind it at all. Again, that if I met the idea of a god sacrificing himself to himself, see the quotation opposite the title page of Dymer. I liked it very much and was mysteriously moved by it. Again, the idea of the dying and reviving god like Balder, Adonis, Bacchus, similarly moved me, provided I met it anywhere except in the Gospels. Lewis actually put these lines from the Havamal opposite the title page of Dymer. Nine nights I hung upon the tree, wounded with the spear of an offering to Odin, myself sacrificed to myself. This quote connects the poem with Odin, the chief of the Norse gods, revealing the connection between the poem and the sagas. After his conversion, Lewis writes that he believes something of the story of the coming of Christ was anticipated in the myths. They were to the pagan society like the Old Testament was for Israel, a tutor to lead to Christ. The one exception between the ancient myths and the Christian myth is that the Christian story is true. Here again, as a literary artifact, Dymer is a window looking in on Lewis's own faith pilgrimage. Another indicator showing the influence of Norse mythology on Dymer is what might be called the Avian portent. In the sagas, Odin, the chief god of the pantheon, has two ravens, Hugin, whose name meant thought, and Munin, whose name meant memory. These two birds fly all about the various kingdoms and report to Odin what has occurred in that world. These birds do not give omniscience to Odin, but they widen his vision of the world and often give a kind of suggestion as to what is ahead. This use of birds to indicate what is coming is not an unusual device in literature. Chaucer and Shakespeare often use the song or call of birds, particularly larks, cuckoos, crows, or vultures, to indicate what is ahead. Lewis uses this device in Dymer. One cannot read the poem without noticing the presence of birds and the frequency of their signaling what is to come. Birds guide Dymer out of the city and into nature. Foreboding events are signaled by the flight of crows. In all, there are 31 references to birds in the poem, and in most cases, they are portents of what is to come. One particular negative example occurs when Dymer witnesses the shooting of a singing lark. This happens just before he comes to the house of the magician. On his arrival, the magician asks, "Have you heard my gun? It was but now I killed a lark." "What, sir?" said Dymer. "Shooting the singing bird?" "Sir," said the man, "they sing from dawn till dark and interrupt my dreams." This signals what is to come. Dymer was sufficiently warned that nothing good was likely to occur at the magician's house. It is also a portent of what is ahead in much of Lewis's writing. Virtually all of his evil characters are cruel to animals. Furthermore, this cruelty grows to become a cruelty towards humans as well. Nevertheless, for our purposes here, it is only important to note this further sign that the Norse myths influenced Lewis as he wrote Dymer. The idea of myth as a literary form by which Lewis can connect both his love of myth and his interest in the idea of longing is present in Dymer. There is more to say about the nature of longing, but we must move now from implicit influences to those that Lewis explicitly identifies in his preface. Explicit Lewis influences on Dymer. Lewis identifies at least four concepts he is influenced by as he writes Dymer. These are the idea of escape, his rejection of the Christiana dreams, his doubts about the new psychology, and his interest in the longings that stirred him and still troubled him since childhood. Escape. Lewis wrote, "My hero was to be a man escaping from illusion." Lewis's hero is a man. Dymer is a particular man, not a mere abstraction or a universal man or an everyman. In a letter written to his brother nearly contemporaneously to the publication of Dymer, Lewis acknowledges that though abstractions and generalizations have their positive use, they can also become distractions. He notes where they are likely to go amiss. The 18th century was fond of personifying abstractions. Quote, corruption had seized the provinces, etc. And because Carlyle carried that further and gave a tinge of poetry in his French Revolution, once it passed into every writer who wants to write impressively on political and historical subjects, we have now reached a stage at which causes, movements, tendencies, etc., are talked of as if they were real things who did things, as if it were Bolshevism, not Bolsheviks, who fomented revolutions, and the revolutionary spirit instead of the revolutionary spirits which made men drunk. It is not a particular Bolshevik with whom I may debate, but rather I make a pronouncement against all Bolsheviks. Universalizing my claims, I can leave out significant exceptions that might count against my judgments. Dymer is a man escaping from illusions. One of the great illusions of this, and perhaps of any day, is to break free of wholesale categorizations. Again, categorizations have a rhetorical value when used very cautiously. What is the point of all this, and why is it relevant? Lewis scholar Bruce Edwards once observed to me in conversation that the academic enterprise consisted of seeing patterns and exceptions. If one never saw the patterns, no generalizations or abstractions necessary to pass on a body of knowledge could be made. That is a rhetorical value. On the other hand, without recognition of the exceptions, the generalizations are always false. As Lewis observed, there is nothing in the history of thought like a shoreline in geography. One minute I'm in the water, next step, I'm on the sandy shore. One minute I'm studying the Middle Ages, the next I'm studying the Renaissance. Yet nobody was running around in the Middle Ages saying, I live in the Middle Ages. As Lewis rightly observed, periodizing may be an academic necessity on one level, but to the degree we fail to recognize we are doing it, we may unwittingly universalize judgments and thereby inflate our own estimation of a particular matter. Furthermore, to the degree we become emotionally involved in the use of abstractions, we can create assumptions by which we make judgments of others who do not see things as we see them. Taken in by such subjectivism, we fail to recognize complexities and exceptions that exist beyond our scope of things. Those who do not see matters as we see them, or as our party tends to see them, can be dismissed with a mere roll of the eyes. Lewis, when he's at his best, will not allow this to occur. He's not writing about men, but a man. He's not making a universal judgment, but a particular one. Here is the life of one man, Dymer. Here are his circumstances, given his unique situation. This is how he responded, for good or for ill. As the poem unfolds, we see that his choices are full of consequences, both good and bad. That is, they are fraught with the kind of complexities honest assessments would lead us to expect. We make no universal judgments. We must wait and see what will happen. Furthermore, Dymer's story is complex, full of inflated assumptions and the consequences of erroneous judgments. A universal judgment that his acts were bad would vilify those elements in Dymer's choices that were good. And a universal judgment of good would tend to overlook the bad. Dymer is a man escaping from illusion. Those who read this poem closely may benefit from the fact that this is so. In some ways, Lewis's approach to Dymer and his conscious awareness of the problems of abstraction has much to say to us today, where our own cultural and political dismissiveness of others has led to great incivility. We do not listen. We just assume we have fully grasped both our position and that of others. We self-referentially prejudge situations beyond merit, justifying in our minds our own prejudices while calling out what we perceive to be the prejudices of others. We cannot hear nor believe that there might be nuances in the positions of others that would make them seem reasonable. We already know what is wrong with their party, so we do not have to listen any longer. Dymer is a man. He's not the universal man. He's not every man. He is a particular man in an imagined set of circumstances, and we get to wander into his story to see and experience what he saw and endured, given the framework and limitations of his story. When this works best, it is possible for us to see in a world such as Dymer's the kinds of things we experience in our own world. We are told that Dymer is a man escaping. From what is he escaping? Certainly there are many kinds of escape in Dymer. He escapes from the city. He escapes from the castle, and then he cannot re-enter. He escapes from the magician's house and his spells. He must even escape from false notions of himself. Lewis uses the phrase in Canto 1, verse 13, that in Dymer's escape from the city, he goes beyond the wall. The idea of a hero escaping beyond the wall occurs often in Lewis. For instance, in Spirits in Bondage, a book published before Dymer, Lewis wrote, "I catch a sight of lands beyond the wall. I see a strange God's face, and someday this will work upon me so. I shall arise and leave both friends and home, and over many lands a pilgrim go through alien woods and foam, seeking the last steep edges of the earth, whence I may leap into that gulf of light, wherein before my narrowing self had birth, part of me lived aright." The escape from some boundary in order to find an object that would fulfill a mysterious, deep-seated desire is an evidence in much of Lewis's fiction. This is an early expression of that. Furthermore, Lewis explains that Dymer seeks to capture the extreme anarchism that characterized much of the world when he first penned the story. Nevertheless, Dymer's bolt from the city was not rooted in a self-referential anarchy, but in a quest to leave the contrived and unreal to find the real. Dymer is a man, not merely fleeing a city, but also fleeing a false notion of the world around him, perhaps even a false notion of himself. In other words, Dymer is a man escaping from illusion. Lewis writes much about the idea of escape in literature throughout his career as a writer. This is seen in his works of nonfiction, like An Experiment in Criticism or Of Other Worlds. However, Lewis also includes the idea of escape in his fiction. The Great Divorce, That Hideous Strength, The Horse and His Boy, Until We Have Faces come immediately to mind. One thing is apparent to the reader, Lewis's interest in a man escaping from illusion is another depiction of reality as iconoclastic. Christiana dreams. When Lewis warns against the Christiana dreams, what did he mean? Something of his concern could be seen in what he had to say about his own experiences while a student. In those days, the new psychology was just beginning to make itself felt in circles I most frequented at Oxford. This joined forces with the fact that we felt ourselves, as young men always do, to be escaping from illusions of adolescence, and as a result, we were much exercised about the problem of fantasy or wishful thinking. The Christiana dream, as we called it, after Christiana Pontifex in Butler's novel, was the hidden enemy whom we were all determined to unmask and defeat. My hero, therefore, had to be a man who had succumbed to its allurements and finally got the better of them. Now, this is an interesting point. In Butler's novel, the woman's name is not Christiana, it's Christina. But Lewis gets it wrong, and he never corrects it. So throughout the rest of the lecture, if I'm referring to Butler, I'm going to say it as Butler wrote it. If I refer to Lewis, I'll say it as Lewis wrote it. But it's an interesting thing to see. Later in the preface, Lewis adds, "By the time I wrote Dymer, I had come under the influence of our common obsession about Christiana dreams into a state of angry revolt against that spell. I regard it as the very type of illusions I was trying to escape from. First, let me bring definition to the Christiana dream. Lewis's former student, longtime friend and biographer George Serre claims that the main subject of Dymer is without doubt the temptation of fantasies. And these fantasies are what Lewis calls Christiana dreams, so Serre writes. Serre asserts that these dreams speak of the awakening of sexual desire and the fantasies of adolescence. They're about sexual interests and attraction. Furthermore, he says that Dymer was written by Lewis in a state of angry revolt against that spell. I think Serre is wrong in his assessment. First, Lewis wrote the poem over nearly a decade. It's hard to imagine he sustained a state of angry revolt for such a long spell. Second, the Christiana dream is not inherently a sexual fantasy at all. Some familiar with Samuel Butler's novel will correct the misunderstanding here. Some familiarity with Samuel Butler's novel will correct the misunderstanding here, which is important to do if one is to grasp Lewis's point properly and interpret the poem accurately. Christina Pontifex is not a person to arouse the libido. In fact, she is simply a rather uninteresting and compliant character. When the reader first meets her, she appears manipulative as she connives ways to get Theobald Pontifex to marry her. Theobald is not the most desirable of men. He's not even a man her parents are very fond of. But a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. She prefers marriage to anyone readily available rather than to accept the single life. Christina is older than Theobald, and recognizing her prospects for marriage are diminishing, plays a round of poker with her four other unmarried sisters for the unrivaled position of seeking the hand of the new assistant to her pastor father. She cultivates what Butler calls the mammon of righteousness. If she walks circumspectly and plays her part well, that is, if she practices righteousness before the young pastoral intern, she may win the rewards of righteousness. Her route in this regard is one of compliance. Nevertheless, once she has landed her husband, she nearly loses her identity by constantly caving into the rigid and rather unreasonable Theobald. Christina is anything but an object of sexual desire. Simply put, she's not even an accurate representation of a woman. She has lost her identity, becoming utterly complacent to the wishes of the man who becomes her husband. Furthermore, whenever there seems to be a conflict of interest between Christina and her husband, she is always deferential. In this way, Christina Pontifex represents a false notion of reality and a false notion of women. One should not expect another human being to be so malleable to the wishes of others. This is the Christiana dream, to see others as a mere extension of one's own projection. Several examples from Butler's novel can demonstrate the point. First, prior to her engagement, throughout the betrothal period, and even after marriage, Christina suppresses her wishes and desires to the interest of her husband. Second, after their marriage, on the first night of their honeymoon, a conflict arises, and Theobald makes it clear that he was master now. Christina, losing her way in the conflict, yields to the thoughtless demands and begs his forgiveness for failing to obey him, acknowledging that, of course, he is right. Their honeymoon was little more than a wife training school, a sort of marital boot camp. In fact, Butler notes the end of the honeymoon saw Mrs. Theobald the most devotedly obsequious wife in all England. Third, in times of difficulty outside the home and in the parish where Theobald comes to pastor, Christina comes to see her role in life as little more than to admire him publicly, await him whenever he is away from home, and assure him whenever he returns. Her principal duty was, as she well said to her husband, to love him, honor him, and keep him in good temper, so says Butler. Fourth, Butler observes, oh, what a comfort it was to Theobald to reflect that he had a wife on whom he could rely never to cost him a sixpence of unauthorized expenditure. Letting alone her absolute submission to the perfect coincidence of her opinion with his own on every subject and her constant assurances to him that he was right in everything which he took in his head to say or do. What a tower of strength to him was her exactness in money matters. As years went by, he became as fond of his wife as it was in his nature to be fond of any living thing, and applauded himself for having stuck to his engagement, a piece of virtue of which he was now reaping the reward. To read Butler is to remove all ambiguity of what Lewis meant about Christina dreams. These dreams were all self-referential and utilitarian. Theobald Pontifex loses all touch with reality when he becomes the center of his world. Others matter if and only if they matter to him. Lewis's concern is to show in Dymer that reality is not at all like the Christiana dream, because reality is iconoclastic. Facing the world as it is, Dymer must break free of his false notions and projections. He must, as Lewis says, face reality. Further clarity about the Christiana dream can be found by looking ahead to what Lewis wrote of Butler's novel In the Four Loves. He says, there is a perversion of family affection that tyrannizes by the need to be needed. It is controlling and solicitous. When looking for literary characters to make his point, he draws on the character Theobald Pontifex and writes, the egregious Mr. Pontifex in The Way of All Flesh is outraged to discover that his son does not love him. It is unnatural for a boy not to love his own father. It never occurs to him to ask whether since the first day the boy can remember, he has ever done or said anything that could excite love. Theobald boxes in his son as well as Christina. He coerces them to become nothing more than extensions of his warped imagination. Christina does not represent reality at all. Lewis came to realize that his imagined adolescent view of women fed by the Butler character was not at all accurate. Theobald in the novel is the culprit. Borrowing from Charles Williams, Theobald experiences his own descent into hell, and Christiana dreams enable him to do this. The problem would occur to anyone who failed to see the complexities of the real world, choosing only to believe one's own projection. Robert Browning in his poem Rabbi Ben Ezra says, then welcome each rebuff that turns earth's smoothness rough. Welcome those complexities that help you to see the world as it truly is rather than how you would have it be. Lewis was beginning to value a reality that a reality as iconoclastic approach to life, and Christiana dreams were antithetical to that value. Reality is not at all as Butler portrays this woman. Lewis would write much later in his career, and coming to understand anything, we must reject the facts as they are for us in favor of the facts as they are. A careless read of Dymer might lead one to think the Christina dream was an allusion to some sort of sexual fantasy, especially since Dymer temporarily falls to the temptation of the salacious dreams the magician seeks to foster on him. The dream, the approach to reality that is self-projective rather than self-aware, will certainly make one susceptible to any number of temptations. But the Christiana dream itself is not a sexual fantasy. Dymer has been on a quest to find the woman he abandoned in the castle. Nevertheless, it is a mistake to believe Dymer's sole motivation to find is sexual satisfaction. In fact, Dymer's interest in finding the woman, once again, is for something much deeper. He wants to escape his own cowardice. Furthermore, he wants to find the woman as she truly is, and that is more than what he projected on her during their tryst in the castle. He realized how shabby he had been after leaving the castle, and that he did not even know her name. He regretted that he used her, and Lewis's rhetorical interests lie elsewhere. The new psychology. Dymer, in his quest to escape from illusion, longs for the real wherever it may lead him. Yet in his pilgrimage in Cantos 6 and 7, he comes upon the magician who seeks to draw him back into the veil of illusion and the world of dreams. The magician's home and all about it is built to block out any reminder of the real world. A hedge surrounds it and blocks out all traces of the world beyond. There's a clock tower, but the clock is broken and no indications of real time interrupt to falsify that world the magician has created for himself. The magician announces to Dymer shortly after they meet that he was the one who killed the lark. His motive, they interrupted his dreams. He will have nothing of the real world that he might remain in the fiction of his own making. It is in the presence of this magician one could gain the impression that the Christiana dream had a sexual connotation. This is because Lewis here connects the Christiana projection with the new psychology. He is showing that a dominating subjectivity can lead to any amount of evil. The new psychology, as Lewis saw it, interpreted the actions of others as merely desire to fulfill wishes and experience pleasure, or the avoidance of fear fulfillments in an attempt to escape pain. This new psychology was rooted in Freudian thought and, as Lewis depicted it, sought to find underlying causes for everything. In Dymer, Lewis embodies the abuses of the new psychology in the House of the Magician. Lewis writes of this new psychology in Surprise by Joy. The new psychology was at that time sweeping through us all. We did not swallow it whole, few people did, but we were all influenced. What we were most concerned about was fantasy or wishful thinking, for of course we were all poets and critics and set a high, very high value on imagination. So it became important to distinguish imagination, not only as Coleridge did from fancy, but also from fantasy as the psychologists understood that term. Now what I asked myself, were all my delectable mountains and western gardens but sheer fantasies? These were the things that had awakened his longing and desire. Had they not revealed their true nature by luring me time and time again into undisguisedly erotic reverie of the squalid nightmare of magic? Lewis is connecting the new psychology to magic is not wasted on those who read Dymer. Those longings awakened in Lewis as a child seemed to evaporate as he drifted towards his years as an atheist and materialist. He could explain them all away as mere wish fulfillment dreams. For a time, he suppressed the very desire in him, which was awakened by the vivid scenes of nature that he loved. These were only mere fantasies, wish fulfillment dreams. These things were explained away as being caused by the disappointments of his childhood, the early death of his mother, the estrangement he often felt from his father, or the disappointments he experienced at school. On the other hand, the deep desire and the longings he so felt were not real. This new psychology took him in, but only briefly, with its wishful thinking, providing his imagination with whatever he wanted. By the time Lewis wrote Dymer, however, he was strongly second-guessing the new psychology, and the longings were again finding quarter in his heart and mind. He began once again to suspect that they might actually be for some real, not merely imagined object. Therefore, he wrote in the preface, "My hero, therefore, had to be a man who had succumbed to its allurements and finally got the better of them." But the particular form in which this was worked out depended on two particularities of my own history, Lewis wrote. These two particularities were the Christiana dream, that false notion of reality, and the deep longings he was beginning to rediscover as indicators of the substantially real and transcendent. It is time to return to the turn attention to the longings. Again in his autobiography, as well as his preface to the second printing of Dymer, Lewis linked the myths with a stirring up of a deep sense of longing within him. I want to turn attention to the kinds of qualities of these longings. Lewis's desire, and in some ways the preoccupation of his early life, was to find the object of his longing. Dymer, too, is questing to find something, but the object is never completely clear. Lewis writes Dymer as he is closing in on the day when he would discover God as the object of these deep-seated desires. In fact, his conversion would follow only 5 years after the publication of Dymer. In virtually all of his books, Lewis gives indication of these longings. Dymer, in this regard, is not unique. Lewis's The Pilgrim's Regress, an allegorical apology for Christianity, reason, and romanticism, was the first book he published after Dymer. This was his first explicitly Christian book, and he wrote the first draft only a year after his conversion over a period of a few weeks while vacationing in the Belfast home of his friend Arthur Greaves. This is Lewis's only allegory, and the hero John is on a quest to escape from illusions. He is living in a town called Puritania, in some ways not unlike Dymer City. He sees a vision of an island and awakens in his heart a longing to find the island. John must also break free and go beyond a wall to begin his pilgrim quest for this object of his desire. Ultimately, he seeks to find that which can unite both his reason and the romantic longings of his heart. In his travels, John comes to a hermit who in the allegory represents history. The hermit refers to God as the landlord. In addition, the hermit says the landlord succeeded in getting a lot of messages through. By these messages, Lewis refers to the myths in pagan times or stories from other times. The hermit says that these stories were one of the means by which the world awakens to long for God. The hermit speaks of three primary kinds of myth, and the specific periods in history when the particular flavor of longing was most developed. First, during pagan times, longing for a place or east or west of the world. This was observed in classical literature. It is a longing depicted by Homer's Odyssey, in which Ulysses desires to return to his beloved Penelope at his home in Ithaca. Virgil also writes of it in the Aeneid, where the hero of the story is caught between Troy and the city of his birth and the Rome, that city that will one day be. This is a longing for place. One could say it is a heaven longing. And Dymer Lewis depicts something like this longing when Dymer sees the real world from the window of the lecture hall in the city, and he bolts from the artificial to quest for the real. It is also seen in the made-up world of the magician and Dymer's willingness at all costs to break free from the illusions to that which is substantive. Second, the hermit says, during medium avum, or Middle Ages, the longing was awakened by a picture or image of a lady. The reference is to Dante and the image of Beatrice, but it is also suggested by Guillaume de Lory's The Romance of the Rose, and perhaps again in Chaucer's Troilus and Cressida. Lewis depicts a similar longing in Dymer. It is first manifest when Dymer has his tryst with the real woman in the castle. This inspires his pilgrimage to seek for her. In a manner not unlike Dante, Dymer discovers the longing for the lady is ultimately a longing for God. After leaving the magician's house wounded and broken, he encounters his lady. He discovers that she is a goddess and that somehow God has prompted all of his questing. The Lewis of Dymer has none of the assurances the mature Lewis would find. His Dymer asks the goddess, "Give me the truth. I ask not now for pity. When God's call, can the following them be sin? Was it false light that lured me from the city? Where was the path, without it or within? Has heaven no voice to help? Must things of dust guess their own way in the dark?" She said, "They must." Then Dymer cries in wrath, saying, "You came in human shape and sweet disguise, wooing me, lurking in my path." He says in anguish, "All was lies." Then the goddess answers, "For our kind must come to all if bidden, but in the shape for which they call." Dymer discovers what Dante discovered, ironically, that Lewis had yet to discover. Third, in the Romantic era, the hermit says the longing was awakened by landscapes and nature. The images are depicted in works like Wordsworth's The Prelude and other Romantic poets captured by the poets. These poets recognized on the threshold of the industrial age the spoiling of nature and more. The polluting without was only a symptom of pollution within. The poets longed to return to the pure, the unspoiled, and the lost innocence of youth. They sought a return to that which might restore the soul. Nature was believed to be the object of their longing. Lewis captures something of this in his poem. Dymer finds a kind of temporary refreshment for his soul once he has gotten beyond the walls of the city and is out in the open spaces. He finds it again after his disappointments at the castle. Again, he takes solace in nature after witnessing the complaints and the death of the wounded man. But none of it ultimately satisfies. In Canto 5, Dymer experiences one of his brief periods of rest and recovery in nature, but it does not hold him for long. He suddenly begins to vent his anger and contempt at the god of nature. This too sounds similar to Lewis's own story. As this canto begins, all he has seen and heard dumbfound Dymer. He rushes further into the wood in an attempt to run from the horrors of the dead man he left behind. However, he does not gain any kind of permanent solace for his grief, even from nature. Within him is triggered a long complaint against the gods, which continues for nearly one-third of the canto. The complaint is consistent with the kind of anger Lewis himself claims to have had around the time of the poem's composition, a time of pre-Christian angst directed at God. Dymer's cry at the end of his long complaint is, "Great God, take back your world." This complaint comes from the mouth of Dymer. He is the very one the reader has learned tends to misjudge matters. He is a man who frequently needs to be undeceived. His life in process of constant accommodation is in process of constant accommodation to reality. In addition, it is a curious feature of the narrative that the complaint, unlike those found in other myths, is here against God, capital G, and not the gods, small g. Perhaps here there is evidence that the author has not properly distanced himself from his protagonist. This incongruity cannot be ignored. Dymer finds rest in nature, yet complains against the god of nature. He longs for rest, but cannot quiet the nightmare within. Even here, we see evidence of this third type of longing, the very desire to have the brokenness within fixed and restored. There is no redemption in Dymer. Nevertheless, Dymer accepts his destiny that he must yield his life to set right the things he has done. Once he has died in a brief battle with the monster who was his own offspring, all of nature reawakens and is restored. Of course, this is nothing like Christianity, the Christianity Lewis would come to accept. Nevertheless, it depicts the longing to have the broken and wounded mended and healed. Interestingly, Evelyn Underhill, who wrote of these three longings, also wrote of these three longings. I quote her here to show that others have detected the same longings, and also because she writes of them with her clarity, better clarity than the unconverted Lewis could depict them. Underhill says, there are three deep cravings of the self, three great expressions of man's restlessness, which only mystic truth can fully satisfy. The first is a craving that makes him a pilgrim and a wanderer. It is a longing to go out from his normal world in search of a lost home and a better country. The next is that craving of heart for heart, the soul for its perfect mate, which makes him a lover. And the third is the craving for inward purity and perfection, which makes him an ascetic and, in the last resort, a saint. These longings were among the explicit influences on Lewis as he wrote Dymer. Let me say it again, Dymer is an important literary artifact that reveals much about Lewis as a writer. In this lecture, we have seen once again development of the theme that reality is iconoclastic. Furthermore, we have looked at those influences on Lewis as he wrote, both implicit and explicit, that which was brooding beneath the strength of things. These are the streams that fed the river from which Lewis drew as he created Dymer. My next lecture will look at what is in German Dymer that comes to full flower in his later work.
Jerry, you know, I have benefited so deeply from your friendship for 25 years, your generosity to me, allowing me to accompany you into places and friendships and experiences that I just would not have known, but through you. That said, to say to someone, you meet someone, you say, I'm a friend of Jerry Roots around here, it's a little bit like saying Jesus loves me. You say, no, really, we're friends. But this doesn't feel quite like that, I want to say. So imagine. I am answering the call, Jerry, to respond to the paper offered by my dear friend of many years on the question of influences active in the mind and heart of C.S. Lewis as he wrote his epic poem, Dymer. Early on the road to becoming the writer that we have all come to know, many to revere, Dr. Root has asked us to consider that Dymer is a significant step along this road for Lewis, and furthermore, that by considering and identifying his influences, we can make some inferences about his artistic footfalls. Why the faint print in the snow happened here and not there. I have the bracing opportunity to offer my thoughts in a room that is beautifully, some might even say densely populated, by friends and colleagues who, without many exceptions, know more about C.S. Lewis than I do, and almost certainly more about literary scholarship as well. So, my only hope, it seems, is to find my lane and stay in it. If I veer right or left into areas of expertise so abundantly present here, you're likely to hear the sound I associate with a drowning character in a Warner Brothers cartoon who swans in over his head and disappears, Next thing you hear are the single bubbles rising to the surface. Help! Help! So what is my lane? What can I offer that might be useful to this discussion? Does anyone here remember a 1981 film? You're all too young. Mephisto, German film. In it, Klaus Maria Brandauer plays an actor who comes to prominence in Nazi Germany, where his craft and career, through a long series of incremental choices, come finally, horrifyingly, under the total sway of the Reich. In the film's powerful last scene, which takes place at night in the cavernous Olympiastadion, that enormous edifice erected by the Führer, the actor is caught, literally and metaphorically, trying to flee the crosshairs of Klieg lights that have both trapped and illuminated him in the vast expanse of the Stadion's floor. And in the last frames of this 2.5-hour film, he looks directly into the camera and offers his only line of defense. Ich bin nur ein Schauspieler. I am only an actor. If I have anything to offer in response to Dr. Root's paper this evening, we will all be better served if I stick to that claim. What I know about the subject, I do not know through the kind of passionate and meticulous research offered by Dr. Root. It is offered instead anecdotally as a series of surmises, stories, more importantly, questions, gained from 40 years as a theater maker. So for better or for worse, ich bin nur ein Schauspieler. I have to say right off the bat that I believe that what we are trying to consider and describe here, what might act as influences on what an artist produces, is at best a pretty inexact exercise. In other words, why we make what we make, and even to go further, the thing we make, in a very real way stands or falls on its own without any hope of the kind of defense provided by the kinds of explanations we are gathered to consider this evening. While we can certainly pursue with some expectation of fruit this kind of discussion, I also hope that we can agree that there is part of a meaning that lies exclusively in reception. Brief story on this point. Who is old enough to remember when video players first were introduced to cars? We called ours the silver bullet, and it was only utilized late in the day on long car trips. The two daughters we had at the time, ages 4 and 2, were absolutely mesmerized by it. And the hypnotic effect seemed relatively unrelated to the content, all without Benadryl. Laugh of recognition. On one trip to New York, my wife and I popped a not very sophisticated animated version of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe into the player. Ruby, our 2-year-old, went to sleep immediately, and Olivia, our 4-year-old, fell silent. Mary and I went about our business in the front seat, and till we heard a sound from the back seat that was absolutely unlike any we had ever heard our daughter make before. We looked back to discover Olivia sobbing hysterically and laughing simultaneously, tears streaming down her face. And then the words, he's alive. Mama, Daddy, Aslan's not dead, he's alive. Reception. But back to influences. As a young actor, I had a rare opportunity to hear in person, in a room about half this size, the great filmmaker Ingmar Bergman speaking to a very small group of actors and artists. Bergman said something that evening in response to a question about his own way forward as a maker, in other words, his process, I have not forgotten. He said, no Swedish accent, I shoot an arrow into the dark. Then I follow that arrow. When I find it, I try to discern why it landed here and not over there. And then a wry smile. It is a very boring process. I think that in the preface to the second edition of Dymer, Lewis is, in a way, trying to do a bit of the same thing. He is, in a sense, collecting his arrows. However, unlike Bergman in his process example, Lewis is doing so with a bit of reticence and at a distance of almost 25 years. Furthermore, he is not doing it to plot his way forward, but rather to do some kind of clarifying work so that, quote, his poem might not be misunderstood by those who read it now for the first time. Here I feel the warning strips on the pavement beneath the tires of my car start to vibrate a little bit. Who can disagree that Lewis, with characteristic generosity, is assisting his readers, or trying to, with a few pieces of context? But I am of the opinion that when we make the kind of art that demands to be released into the world, our efforts to keep readers or viewers from misunderstanding it are largely futile. Now, I want to make it clear, I think it is quite possible to under-understand. I am unwilling and underqualified to claim with the same authority that our colleague, Dr. Jeffrey Davis, did, so deftly balancing winsomeness and clarity, in response to Dr. Root's first paper a few weeks ago, that Dymer is simply not a very good poem. I seek to model here what I teach theater students, that to critique above the level you have achieved must be done with an awareness of thin ice and extraordinary humility. You didn't like the performance of Hamlet you saw? Oh, what was it like when you played it? Writing an epic poem, and a good one, is probably pretty hard. I will not venture to critique Dymer, but I am willing to say I was seldom compelled by it. And while I'm being confessional, I must offer here that Lewis's series of valid and illuminating points in Dymer's preface, offered so that we might not misunderstand his poem, presumes some measure of comfort in Plato, Wagner, Siegfried, the Asperian or Western Garden Method, Euripides, Milton Morris, the early Yeats, Voltaire, the later Yeats that Lewis visited in his occultist salon, full stop, exclamation. Oh, Lucretius, Goethe, Huxley, others, help. If there's any comfort for the rest of us, I believe that it is in my suggestion that we do understand or don't understand or misunderstand or even horrors are profoundly bored by nine cantos of Dymer for a different set of reasons entirely. Perhaps then it is possible for Lewis to work out well in his preface. A further word here about artists and influences, but in a slightly different cast than the one we have been entertaining. As an actor in New York, I studied with one of the 20th century's great American acting teachers, Michael Howard, who has a good deal to do with my becoming a teacher myself. Michael has invented many exercises for actors, and one he calls simply the personal monologue. In this exercise, the actor searches his own life for a moment that is what Michael calls close to the bone, and after which life was never quite the same. After identifying the event, the actor writes out the moment in as spare a way as possible, omitting any kind of manipulation of feeling, either for audience or for himself, and then in class, simply reports the event. In the 8 years I studied with Michael, I attempted this exercise twice. The first time, I wrote about an event that happened in my 9th year. I was bicycling with a friend one evening at dusk, returning to my home north of Seattle, and after I had turned across Furlan's Way and into my sloping driveway, my friend attempted to follow, but without looking. He was killed instantly as I watched. A car had come suddenly around the corner, and it struck him. In writing this event initially, I was stuck on my role as a traumatized child, witnessing death in a horrible way. This was true. But what emerged as a far more influential, what emerged as far more significant or influential, as I wrote and sifted and rewrote the story, was the fact that I had always considered this young boy a tag-along. And in my 9-year-old self, the celebrity status I received at school following this event far more deeply impacted me than the loss of this boy's life. If I were to create some piece of art influenced by this event, searching those feelings and their lingering effect would undoubtedly bear more artistic fruit. Influence in the life of an artist is tricky business. The second time I attempted the personal monologue, the tone was very different. I wrote simply, about my brother Peter's left hand as it shot free throw at the district basketball tournament in Lyndon, Washington in 1968. I don't know why that moment. It's caught up somewhere in a ball of love for my brother and pride and my 11th birthday and the simple visual grace of that image to me. The point I'm making is that the scale of an event does not always equal the import of its influence to an artist. Consider here Lewis's own story about Aslan's entrance into The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. In George Sayer's account, it was only after Lewis had written a good deal of the book that he got the idea for the lion Aslan, who came bounding into it. Jack had been having a good many dreams about lions at the time. I love that. And once he, Aslan, was there, he pulled this whole story together, and soon he pulled the other six stories in after him. Now, can you imagine Narnia without Aslan? Apparently, Lewis, for a time, did. It was Bergman, again, following his arrows. Right? On the other hand, I do not get a strong feeling when I read Dymer that the poem's main character ever meaningfully contradicts its young author. In the way that I believe Lewis intends it in his preface, his recounting that the story simply came to him at the tender age of 17 seems to me part of the problem with it. There is a kind of inevitability, logic to the poem that does not allow the organic gasp that the bounding lion out of a dream provides. Relatedly, as early as Canto 10, when Dymer whacks his professor for silencing his yawn, a cautionary tale, surely, for academics, and the poem simply moves on past the event, we know we are in for a certain kind of experience, an experience where characters and events symbolize things, and with apologies, where it is quite possible to misunderstand or misreceive the meaning of the poem. An old theater adage proves true here. A man is walking down the street and he slips on a banana peel. Whether he pops up and does a take to the audience or continues to lie on the sidewalk writhing in pain tells us everything about the nature of the story we're experiencing. Dymer's actions early in the poem oddly do not seem truly to invite us to take the epic journey with him. They seem instead to be demonstrated rather than lived through. I'm not sure, Jerry, that I can agree that Dymer is a man meant to be considered as a man living through a unique experience. There was one quote in Dymer's preface that I recognized, and it was not even cited. I felt very accomplished. Although, to be honest, the quote is from what I believe to be the most frequently produced play on earth. The heresies that men leave are hated most. Guesses? Anybody? What? No. It's Midsummer Night's Dream. Lysander to the sleeping Hermia. Lewis curiously truncates the quote, leaving it awkwardly dangling in what was intended to be the middle of two rhymed couplets. Or, as the heresies that men leave are hated most by those they did deceive, so thou, my surfeit and my heresy, of all be hated but the most of me. Isn't that great? I have had the opportunity to work on Midsummer Night's Dream 5 times in my life, twice as an actor, 3 times as a director, and I'd like to linger with it for just a few moments as we wrap this up. It's a play that is a beautifully organic whole, but whose constituents' parts seem to have been stitched together from some crazy quilt dream. Even if you know the play well, I defy you to turn and simply summarize the plot to the person sitting next to you. You really can't do it. I tried it at home, I know. And it resembles the part of Narnia that offended J.R. Tolkien so deeply. It's a willy-nilly mishmash of species and mythologies. So unlike the deeply systematic, heavily layered world of Middle-earth. This is the part of the influence conversation that is most interesting to me and certainly hardest to quantify. The unlikely part. Lewis's surprise visitor, the bounding lion from his dreams. Another evening, perhaps. Professor Alan Jacobs reminded me in a recent conversation that for the Elizabethans, the imagination was almost always cast as a threatening thing, something false, something to mistrust. Think of the Apostle Paul, vain dreams, vain imagination. Isn't that true? So in Midsummer, the rationalist Duke Theseus, making his second appearance this evening, is clearly understood by his audience when he says, I never may believe these antique fables or these fairy toys. Lovers and madmen have such seething brains, such shaping fantasies that apprehend more than cool reason ever comprehends. The lunatic, the lover, and the poet are of imagination all compact. One sees more devils than vast hell can hold. That is the madman. The lover, all is frantic, sees Helen's beauty in a brow of Egypt. The poet's eye, in a fine frenzy rolling, doth glance from heaven to earth, from earth to heaven. And his imagination bodies forth of forms and things unknown, the poet's pen turns them to shapes and gives to airy nothing a local habitation and a name. Such tricks hath strong imagination that if it would but apprehend some joy, it comprehends some bringer of that joy, or in the night imagining some fear, how easy is a bush supposed a bear. I love Hippolyta's response, and I'd like it to speak for me. But all the story of the night told over, and all their dreams transfigured so together, more witnesseth than fancy's images, and grows to something of great constancy, howsoever strange and admirable. Or, and finally, C.S. Lewis, Dymer, Canto 1. You, stranger, long before your glance can light upon these words, time will have washed away the moment when I first took pen to write. With all my road before me. Yet, today, if at all, we meet. The unfashioned clay ready to both our hands, both hushed to see that which is nowhere. And yet come forth and be. Thank you.
We will take a 5-minute break now, and then we will have an opportunity to ask questions and hear Jerry and Mark interact.
Yeah. reconvene.
Okay.
Are you going to ask the first question? Am I going to ask the first question?
You should ask.
You sit down there.
Okay. Tell Jerry to start talking. Start talking. Yeah, dude, it's this boy. This is nice.
Testing, testing.
All right, sir.
Wow.
I'm taking my tea with me. That's
these rock.
I'm going to pass the microphone back and forth.
No, I have a. I have one.
You have. Oh, I was going to think. We could be like the Everly Brothers or something.
Who are they? Who are the Everly
Brothers?
They're
back. We're reconvening.
Oh, Phil and Don Everly, the Everly Brothers.
No, I remember them. Bye bye, loneliness. Hello, sweet caress. Think I'm gonna die.
High culture, low culture.
Welcome back. This is our.
Thank you. That's so kind of you. I almost feel like I could do this without, but you probably didn't like this.
I was telling Jerry I enjoyed the framing because from where I was sitting, his head exactly covered Charles Williams. So he looked like one of our seven authors and very distinguished too. This is our talk back time or our pushback time, whatever you want to make of it. And so I'll be passing the mic. Wait for me to hand you the mic because this is being recorded. We want to make sure we get your question. I'm going to start by asking, Lewis considered this to be myth. And in
to be myth.
Uh-huh. And he says in his introduction to George MacDonald that a good myth doesn't have to be told in one form, poetry, prose. Yeah. Do you think this narrative plot line holds up well enough that he could have told it in another form besides cantos of poetry?
Yeah, I think so. And as somebody, I forget who, I heard it here at the Wade Center, was thinking about even making a ballet of Dymer. So you could tell it that way as well. At least somebody's going to try. Marge would know. And then he was interested, too, in the music of Wagner. And the myths were told with music. So he liked that. I think you could do I think, yeah. Yeah. I don't know if that helps, but.
Sure.
Thought you were going to ask me about the animals.
Well, you kind of covered that in your talk. Mm. I was mentioning that people with rifles in Lewis tend to be bad people. In Out of the Silent Planet, Weston shoots one of the Harassa, and then in The Magician's Nephew, Uncle Andrew wants to shoot Aslan. If I only had a rifle, I'd shoot that lion. So I was going to say, are people who own guns bad? That was going to be my question for you.
I don't think people who own guns bad, but in Lewis, people who are cruel to animals tend mm-hmm. to also be evil towards people and cruel towards people. And all of his evil characters are cruel to animals. So you have the NICE, the National Institute of Coordinated Experiments, and they do experiments on animals, and eventually they try to do experiments on humans, and the animals, of course, revolt. You have Uncle Andrew, who you mentioned, who's blowing up guinea pigs. Mm-hmm. Once he blows up guinea pigs, then he tries to send his nephew and his nephew's friend into another world because he's too important mm-hmm. to take any risks. You have the White Witch, Queen Jadis of Charn, who beats the horse Strawberry. And you, and she's cruel to her dwarves and her servants, and she even speaks a deplorable word that destroys her entire world. It destroys her entire world and just saves herself. That's very anti-Aslan. But you have this. And Weston also, he's the most nefarious character in all of Lewis's works. When you first encounter him in Perelandra, he's eviscerating these frog-like right. animals and Perelandra, and he tries to kill also Ransom. So yeah, I think Lewis does a good job depicting this. He wrote an essay too on vivisection where he was opposed to the use of animals, experimentation of animals in schools. And actually I ended up doing some lectures for the Humane Society US about this and did a paper that was published in one of their journals on Lewis's tender-heartedness towards animals. Mm-hmm. And the other, he writes, my neighbors trap the mice they find in their house, but I feed the ones right. I find. You know, he's kind of tender-hearted. So, yeah. Didn't you love Mark's his response?
Yeah. Dream.
Yeah. And anyway, I was just blown away. You can see why he's such a successful actor too. And New York, and if you've ever seen, how many of you have seen him perform here? Yeah, it's incredible. Like when that last depiction he did of Rev Tevye and Fiddler's, Fiddler on the Roof. I just wept and wept as he did that last scene. It was unbelievable. Any other questions?
Life gives us these things, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Life gives us these stories.
I'm starting to work on the Dymer musical. If I were a Dymer.
I sort of like
somewhere.
The idea of a Dymer ballet, because I think it would take away some of the some of that quality I sense in it, that it just kind of marches along. Maybe it would put into it some, I mean, I can imagine the pas de deux. It would be interesting, I think.
See, but the thing is, too, even that, the rhyme scheme, the meter, you know, it's almost the drumbeat of that poem. Here's Lewis, a relatively young in his career, and the discipline he had to lean into in order to produce that poem, I think also benefited him later when he's a little more relaxed in his own skin.
Yeah.
And he starts writing. He paid his stripes. You have to learn the alphabet and grammar before you can write a paper. And I think Lewis was in some senses flexing his wings.
It's interesting. There's a parallel, I think. Young actors sometimes they try to explore the truth of a moment, but they also want to demonstrate the moment.
Uh-huh.
Does that make sense?
Uh-huh.
So that there's a way they want to show you something about. It's slightly illustrative, and it feels like Dymer to me in a way that it doesn't feel like later Lewis that I read.
Uh-huh.
He doesn't seem to be trying to prove to me, you know, that whole angle about how he wanted to be famous. Maybe this is the thing
yeah.
that was going to make him.
Yeah.
Maybe there was something he was after, a kind
yeah.
of a meaning that, you know, I mean, that none of that is apparent in later Lewis.
It's gone.
And boy, when you're trying to do that,
yeah.
when you're trying to prove that
posing
you're
a little bit, you think?
Well,
maybe.
I don't know, posing, but demonstrating.
Uh-huh.
Making it apparent that I'm capable of this. It feels that way to me. I don't know if that's a scholarly observation.
Well, and then later too, he tries to be so dismissive of T.S. Eliot and so on, and you know, he sees Eliot gaining this ascendancy, and sometimes he's a little bit cruel, I think, in
yeah.
some of those things, way back then. But
we should give the audience a chance to ask a question, make a comment.
There's Walter.
So I've tried to understand this poem and have read it and reread it out of loyalty to my good friend Jerry Root. I thought, you know, I owe it to.
We should have t-shirts made.
Yeah, that's it. You know, Jesus loves me and I follow Jerry Root. That's kind of, you know.
Right. And I read Dymer.
And I read Dymer.
As a proof of.
You know, it should give me some merit. And
yeah,
right.
For Jerry's kids.
Yeah.
And so I don't understand very much of it, but there are some lines that just leap off the page, and it's not so much a question as a request for illumination. But these lines, I thought, express so much of that inconsolable longing that is so much a part of Lewis throughout his writing. Chewing the cud of lusts which are despair and fill not, while his mouth gapes dry for bliss that never was. Isn't that the consolable longing right there? It's the sentinel saying to Dymer
yeah.
what he has observed of this monster
yeah.
who is Dymer's son.
Yeah.
And I don't understand that. That makes no sense to me. But just those lines make sense to me. Those lines express what I've experienced, chewing the cud of lusts that fill not.
Mm-hmm.
And the mouth gapes dry for bliss that never was. Could you talk about that? Both of you. I mean, I think that's, for me, that was a couple of lines that leapt off the page.
Mm. There's that sonnet, I wish I could quote it, Shakespeare, about lust in action, about bait, the swallowed bait, and you know, the idea of how it just doesn't pay off. I mean, it's so fantastic.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I love chewing the cud. That's working it, right? I don't know.
Well, Lewis too talks about the dialectic of desire, where you have this longing and you tether it to something and it doesn't fulfill. So you untether and tether it to something else and it doesn't fulfill. And you tether it to something else. He says, longing remains pure only by knowing what it does not want. And so you begin to discover through these things as you grow through life, this thing that you think will fulfill. And you can do it in marriage too. If you expect your wife or husband to do for you what only God can do for you, you'll start projecting those disappointments on your spouse. And they didn't do anything wrong. It was just your misplaced desire. So it's interesting, a contrast between Buddhism, say, and Christianity. You have lots of kinds of Buddhism. So what is the thing that classifies them as Buddhists? And they have this one concern. It was the concern of Siddhartha Gautama when he went out among his people. He was a prince, and he went out among his people. He saw them suffering. And he thought, I want to solve the problem of human suffering. So at the core of Buddhism is that interest. It's a good interest, really. But his thing was he felt that people suffered because they had unfulfilled desire. So if I could eliminate desire, I would then free people from suffering. Well, I had a real dear friend. He eventually became a Christian from reading Surprised by Joy, actually. But his girlfriend died unexpectedly. So he went to Nepal and studied Tibetan Buddhism under the Dalai Lama. One of the things he had to do was go into a mosquito-infested trailer and stay in there for as long as it took him till he didn't care if the mosquitoes bit him again. He was there for a week. And I just heard this and I was horrified by it. And finally, if you could eliminate completely your desire, in some senses you lose your personality into the sort of world soul. Well, Christianity agrees that there are some sorrows that we face because of unfulfilled desire. And here's the sentinel, you know, saying these things, you know, okay, you can chew the cud of lust, but what's going to happen? Eventually you'll be disappointed and so on. Christianity is more, is better expressed by the statement of Augustine that we seek ordo amoris, ordered love. You put God first, you can enjoy these other things for what they are and not expect from them the thing that will ultimately disappoint. The thing that moth and rust destroys and thieves break in and steal. Instead, we find our fulfillment in him. It's like the book of Ecclesiastes. You know, years ago, I read this one. I think it was J. Sidlow Baxter, Explore the Book, but I'm not sure. And he said, did you know him by any chance? He used to live in Santa Barbara. So he said that he thought the poetic books were the how-to books. So Job, how to suffer, Psalms, how to worship in good times and bad times, Proverbs, how to be wise, Song of Solomon, how to love, Ecclesiastes, how to what? How to be confused about life? No, it's how to enjoy life. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity under the sun, because it's said 28 times, under the sun is said 28 times. You will not find true enjoyment if you only have the under the sun perspective. And the reason why is because God has placed eternity in our hearts. And our hearts are restless till they find their rest in thee. So the key verse of Ecclesiastes becomes Ecclesiastes 2:25. It's ordo amoris. For who can eat and who can enjoy life without him? You give me God, I can enjoy life as it comes to me. You take God away, none of this stuff will satisfy. I'm chewing the cud of lust. I have the dialectic of desire. This isn't it. What is it? And we catch Lewis, I think. This is my opinion. I still like Dymer. I'm going to be going to therapy after this session.
Right? I like it more because you like it, Jerry.
But the thing is, though, I think we have a window on where Lewis is, especially when he's reading Hippolytus and then the chapter Checkmate in Surprised by Joy. This was the first step in the move where God gets him into Checkmate. He's writing Dymer while he's reading Hippolytus. So Lewis himself, if you put the pieces of the puzzle together, this stuff is all going on at the same time. And I think Dymer in that regard shows us that he's coming to this through this dialectic of desire. It's not this, it's not this. And finally he's going to see what it is. It's interesting. It's interesting. I don't know if that's helpful or not. But he needs a mic.
Dymer then is,
Dymer then is killed by the brute, the monster, who is his son. But then the brute becomes some shining god.
And all of nature is restored.
And restored.
Yeah.
So what does that have to say about the brute being one who chews the cud of lusts and gapes for bliss that was not? Is that a representation as the son of Dymer, of Dymer's own quest?
Well, I don't know. I mean, you could say that the son is like the father, and maybe the father was like this, so here it comes down, you know. But it may be very different than that. Again, there's no real redemption in Dymer. But and he was going to call it the redemption of Ask, you know, the man in the Nordic myths. But I do think this that you could have it that Dymer, who begat this monster sinfully in some senses, now has to die to set the monster free. And maybe we've got the sentry talking about the monster, but then the monster is restored because of the death of the father. And it could be a kind of convoluted redemption of sorts. I'm not sure, but all the things are restored. It's got this tragic element in it that's so typical of myths and the kinds of things Aristotle writes in Poetics and so on. So I don't know. I'm open.
I would think if you're chewing the cud of lust, you need a new partner. to me, that's part of the failure of Dymer, is the imagery or the metaphors aren't that compelling. It's amazing to me that in Narnia, he comes up with such fascinating, perfect metaphors, but I don't find nearly as many in Dymer. I think it is an apprentice work when you compare it to other parts of Lewis's canon. Other question?
I just wanted to say there's my sister who lives next door to me. And she's the one who first told me about C.S. Lewis.
Oh.
Yeah.
Good evening, Dr. Lewis.
Yeah.
I have a question for you guys regards to the form. So Lewis used the form of an epic to write Dymer. And I'm curious regards to its form, what lends its strength towards Dymer?
Say it again.
The form of an epic.
Yeah.
How does that lend towards, you know, its craft of Dymer? And you guys were considering, you know, turning into a ballet or, you know, perhaps even a film. I know that Marshall McLuhan had written before about how media is the message. And I'm just curious about how changing its form, would it change the message of Dymer? Or would it perhaps illuminate even in greater detail aspects that an epic would not be able to in itself?
Well, I think it's, as Dr. Downing observed, a myth should be able to be told in any form, and it should still work. Lewis distinguishes between two kinds of epics in A Preface to Paradise Lost, and I think last lecture I talked about the fact that this was more like the Virgilian epic, but I don't know. I think if he told it differently, it would still apparently from everybody else, it still wouldn't work.
Yeah, do you if you're trying to write a myth, do you succeed automatically? I mean, seems a little hidden myth to me. Sorry, high culture, low culture. If you have not gotten the theme by now.
Did you want to respond though to this?
No, I don't know. I'm easily out of my depth here. I do think that and it'd be interesting to hear the English professors among us talk about this, but I do think different formats certainly give you a different kind of a power. I mean, the canto, everything is so contained, and if you think of it, you get it in bites, right? A film is so fluid. What I like about a ballet is, you know, it would have a kind of a fluidity to it in the storytelling that you can't do in an epic poem. It's just a different.
But a sonnet is really contained.
Mm-hmm. But it's only one thing. You don't do.
You're just talking
you don't
about
do
one
serial
thing.
Serial sonnets.
There's an essay that Lewis writes called Variation in Shakespeare, and he talks about the fact that Shakespeare can write one sonnet and maybe use seven different metaphors in the one sonnet. So he never gets you to the thing, but he gets you all around the thing. Is there fairness there, or what do you think? You've trafficked
again,
in the sonnets.
I'd love to know what others think, but I guess, boy, once you say the thing, you've said the thing. And I guess I think, boy, that's a good question. Shakespeare never seems to be dancing around anything. You know, when he gives seven different metaphors for the thing, it is a way of illuminating it in a way that helps us and leads us on. But it's a different thing.
Is it? He writes something similar too in an essay called "The Similes of Dante," where Dante used multiple similes to describe things. Is it possible that there are some things that can't be fully described and therefore they're left better said with movement towards an understanding, but open-ended so that we don't deceive ourselves to think we've got it all figured out?
Well, my dad used to say there are some things that are better felt than telt. Huh. I don't know if that is illuminating at all, but I guess it's so interesting to me. The whole act of imagination is so interesting to me. Why we make what we make.
Yeah.
I work with theater students and we do these weird things, you know, for 40 years in this theater group at Wheaton. And we pretend these things, and then I always stop them and I say, hey, just for a moment, put your hand on your heart and just thank God that you can imagine something. Something that was not there, that's only there because somehow it appeared, it came to you, right? It's such a wonderful thing that we do. And I mean, it's, again, this man that you love and we've all been so blessed by. I have not been able to get away from the fawn in the forest with the Christmas packages and the umbrella.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. While it's snowing.
Right?
Well, it's snowing.
Yeah,
he grabbed the wrong thing when he left the house.
And he says Narnia opened up. That to me is just, I could think about that for a long time.
Wow.
Because he wasn't doing anything about it. He wasn't steering it. He wasn't trying to, he was following it. It was Bergman and the arrows. I mean, he was saying, look, I don't know, I'm just going, I'm setting out to find the thing, but I'm going to come here and I'm going to think, well, I thought it was going over there, but it's not.
When you said you have your artists put their hand on their heart and appreciate the fact that they could imagine something that wasn't there, and I'm looking through you to Laura over there, and she would say this is Tolkien-esque, that we are sub-creators, right? That we're made in the image of a creator, and so we can do creative things. Maybe when I put my hand on my heart and imagine something that's not there, I experience in that moment a proximity to God, because I have entered into something of the glory, the creative glory.
I just that's what this whole process has led me into thinking about, just the idea that just the idea of the moment. I love to say that the best ideas, and those of you who write, many of you do, it's a small unprotected idea, right? There's a kind of an idea that happens and you don't even know why it happens. It's there, wasn't there, and now it is there. And if you're gentle and you follow, you sometimes get somewhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
Dymer, again, doesn't feel to me that way. It feels more systematic and like it was a big idea, you know? A big idea in a young man's head, which is a dangerous thing, I think.
Well, what you're talking about, I mean, it is obviously young Lewis, so we hope he's going to mature, and we see that he did. But the one thing that's interesting to me, too, in the Inklings, when Tolkien was reading The Lord of the Rings as he was writing it, he talked about when the Fellowship or the Hobbits get to the Prancing Pony in Bree, and they're supposed to meet somebody there, and he reads to the point where they see in the corner a man under a hooded cape smoking a pipe, and they say to Tolkien, "Who was that man?" And he said, "I don't know. I got to go home and find out."
Oh, I love that. That to me is the. It's a Buechner spoke in chapel many many years ago, talking about Leo Beb, you know, the charlatan preacher, who was a minor character in one book, and became the central figure in four novels, and Buechner says, well, he simply had more to say, right? And I just love that idea that we can be waylaid by an idea that is a small idea, and it takes, you know, flowers. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah, it's great.
It seldom happens to me, but it just is a wonderful thing.
It's not only wonderful, it's also wonderful to hear you talk about it. Yeah.
when I direct a play, I often dream about the play. And lately, this is, if I dream an image, I try to put it into the play.
Wow.
We did a project called the Hamlet Project with 12 women a few years ago. And I had a dream that the actor playing actress playing Gertrude, I just had an image of her standing with a red apple in her mouth. Just a red apple in the middle of her face.
Like a Magritte painting?
I don't know. But but I fought to put it into the play. Well, why? Because it was an unprotected, you know, it was an image. Right, it was something that came to me that I thought, so why not put it in there? It's something that, I don't know why it got there, but it got there. It was pretty cool, you know. Claudius is chasing Gertrude around as Hamlet watches, you know, that scene. And, and she hid behind the door, she was eating the apple, and she stuck it in her mouth. Stood up for the screen. It was good, it worked out.
Was it a good apple?
I don't know, it was red. It was a very red apple. But it's like my brother's hand shooting the free throw.
Jerry, key to your first presentation and this presentation is your aphorism, reality is iconoclastic.
Yeah, really,
and I am having trouble grasping that because icons are, of course, part of reality.
Mm-hmm.
So could you help me understand better what you mean by that?
Yeah. The idea is I you know, my mind sometimes feels like a pickle soaking in the brine of C.S. Lewis, right? Because I traffic in these books, I read them over and over, and I read the books he's referring to and stuff. And just I've just picked up that this is a dominant theme running through all of his books. I think it's the one big idea. But the icon is not bad. Lewis is he becomes fully Christian, and his view of evil is that evil is a perversion of the good. The icon's not bad. Matter of fact, nothing is essentially bad. You don't think of a bad banana without thinking of a good banana that went bad. Evil compares to good more like bread mold compares to bread or something like that. And even creativity, humans can take bread mold and make something healing out of it. Can we at least allow God that level of creativity that he can take human evil and make good out of it? And we see that happens at the Calvary. But the image, I have... Maybe I saw one of Mark's plays, or maybe I read a book, or had a late night conversation with friends, or was visiting with Walton Darlene over some idea, or heard a sermon, whatever, went to a lecture, read a book. And all of a sudden, things that I've been thinking about and trying to get my mind around, maybe things about God, have come together for me. The pieces have come together. And I have a bigger image than I ever had before. And it takes my breath away, as it should. But if I hold on to that image too tightly, it now competes against my having a growing image or a growing understanding. And C.S. Lewis said in Surprised by Joy, God always kicks out the walls of temples we build for him because he wants to give us more of himself. So reality is iconoclastic in the sense that the real world is more complex than any grasp I will ever have of it. We will never get to the bottom of it. I became a Christian in college my freshman year, and I read through the Bible that first year, and I was blown away, because I had been raised to believe if I had a bad thought the last second of my life, I'd go straight to hell, or if I went to a movie and Jesus came back when I was in there, I'd go straight to hell. I wanted to see Shaggy Dog by Walt Disney, but didn't know if it was worth risking my eternal destiny to go see. And the thing is, I read through the Bible. Everybody's messed up. I'm in my 48th read through the whole Bible, and I've read the New Testament another 34 times besides that, Greek Bible a couple times. And every time I read it, and right now I'm reading in Kings, everybody's messed up. Solomon, he doesn't obey the advice he gives to his son in the book of Proverbs. Doesn't mean it's false. Lewis said if you are an alcoholic and you go to a doctor who's an alcoholic and he tells you you shouldn't drink too much, the advice is still good, even though the person it came from was bad. And God obviously inspires Solomon to write brilliant things. His son Rehoboam doesn't obey it. And you see the mess of generation after generation of these different people. And I was reading even about Elijah today. He has this wonderful victory on Mount Carmel. And then he finds out one person wants to hurt him, and he goes running, he's afraid, and he, you know, after he had just seen, I'm the only one, you know, this sort of thing. So I'm reading through, and it's a wonder to me, because I feel like I can identify with all these people. I thought I had to be perfect. They're all messed up. I'm messed up. This is a good place for me. Till I get to the end. It was so anticlimactic. Everybody's saying, you know, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive honor and glory and power and dominion and majesty forever and ever. And I just thought that sounds so boring. And the next year I read the Bible again, and at the end, they were still doing it. They were doing it again. And I go, what are they seeing that I'm not seeing? So I remember when the first time I ever went to the New York Metropolitan Museum of Art, I was with Claudia, you, and Mary. And we came to that Van Gogh's Cypresses in a Wheat Field. And you guys went on. I didn't know where you went. I didn't even pay attention. I was with somebody. I was just transfixed before this poem for a good half hour. And every time I go to New York, I try and go back and see that painting. Or every time I'm in Prague, I want to go see Mucha's Window, the third one on the left, in St. Vita's Cathedral, about Christianity coming to the Slavic people. It's the most beautiful window I've ever seen. Every time I'm there, I go see this window. And I drive down the road, and I see a bunch of people, and they're all looking westward, and I go, what are they looking at? And you look at the sunset, and it begins to dissolve in front of you, and your heart breaks as you see it. We don't have to worry, because God's so generous with these things, he'll give us another one. Or you'll see a bunch of people stop out of their cars, and you go, what are they looking at? And you see a double rainbow in the sky. And I start thinking, I think there are things that are so beautiful that I don't even want to take my eyes off of them. And I wonder if finally we're going to get to heaven and we're going to see all the little images that we did have, as wonderful as they might have been, as much awe as they may have provoked, none of them compared to this one. As a matter of fact, I really don't want to leave this one. I think the real thing, I want to see. I want my eyes fixed on him. I want to drink it in and eat on it forever. No food available, that's okay. I've got this image of God. And I think that's what it is. So the things that I have, helpful as they may be, are only temporarily helpful. God's bigger than our biggest images of him. And a lot of the books that Lewis reads, books I go to because of him, these authors are saying something very similar, if that makes sense. So anyway, we're way past time, I realize. Is that helpful
that's
at
true.
All?
I
Maybe
love
not.
What you said. I still am struggling with the statement itself.
But remember, though, Dr. Downing, Dr. Crystal Downing, remember, I like Dymer, so you can't trust everything I say.
Last word, final word.
Yeah, that's probably a good conclusion.
You have the last word?
No, you.
In conclusion, Dr. Root said, I like Dymer. End of meeting. Thank you.
We should have asked the wedding.